أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا ونبينا وطبيب نفوسنا وحبيب قلوبنا أبي القاسم محمد صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم لا سيما بقية الله روحي وأرواح العالمين لتراب مقدمه الفداء السلام عليك يا أبا الحسن علي بن محمد الزكي الراشد النور الصاغب ورحمة الله وبركاته صلوا على محمد وآل محمد بأعلى أصواتكم اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم My very dear brothers and sisters in Islam السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله الحمد لله that the Almighty God blessed us to be able to step one more time inshallah successfully into the sacred month of Rajab and commemorate tonight the martyrdom anniversary of the 10th Imam Imam Ali an-Naqi Imam al-Hadi عليه وعلى آبائه وأولادهم وأولاده أفضل الصلوات والتحيات. As I just mentioned, we are here tonight to commemorate the martyrdom anniversary of Imam al-Hadi, our 10th Imam, the grandfather of our present Imam, Imam al-Hujjah Jalallahu Ta'ala Farajahu Sharif. Here allow me to convey on behalf of all of us our sincere commiseration and condolences to our present Imam, Imam al-Hujjah Jalallahu Farajahu Sharif, and inshallah this gathering will be a humble dedication to our present Imam. May his soul be pleased with all of us. We have just inshallah successfully stepped into the sacred month of Rajab. As I said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran mentions that inna 'indata ash-shuhura 'inda Allah 12 shahran minha arba'atun hurum. The number of the months of an Islamic calendar are 12, of which 4 of them are sacred months. I'll explain very briefly that in the Islamic calendar, from the time of Prophet Ibrahim, as it was announced, otherwise from the very beginning of the creation of mankind on earth, that has been the rule and the law, apparently according to the teachings of the Quran. But from the time of Prophet Ibrahim, this law was executed was officially introduced, and it was endorsed, of course, by the Prophet of Islam as well, that of the 12 months in the calendar, Islamic calendar that we have, there are 4 months that are known as sacred months, that are holy and sacred, and there must be a special respect given to them. The months of Dhul-Qa'dah, Dhul-Hajjah, the months of Muharram, and then the months of Rajab. The only odd one that is not coming along with is this holy and sacred months of Rajab. historically, even the pre-Muslim Arabs at the time of Jahiliyyah, they were still respecting those 4 months, although sometimes they were really distorting and playing with them to justify their wars. Otherwise, in general, they would respect these 4 months. They would cease any war among themselves and give a special respect to them. In Islam, those who observe the holiness and they respect the sanctity of these 4 months, they will reap a special rewards for them, for themselves. Likewise, sinning in these 4 months, there is a double demerit in it. So in other words, in as we have in our system, in our, let's say, the driving system, there is a double demerit when there's a long weekend or special you know, holidays. In the Islamic law system that we have, there's a double demerit and double merit. In the month of Rajab, every single prayer that inshallah you and I we offer, every day that we may fast inshallah, the rewards of it will be much more than the other months of the year. Likewise, God forbid, if we commit any sin, the punishment will be more severe. Our Arafa, Uliyaullah, they be longing for these especially 3 consecutive months that we have just started, the first one. Although Sha'ban and Ramadan, technically speaking, they are not the sacred months, but they are also very rich in spirituality of it, that sometimes I refer to them, and some brothers, they refer to them as RSR program. The first R stands for Rajab, S stands for Sha'ban, and the second R stands for the holy month of Ramadan. These 3 months, the best opportunity to get into this camp of spiritual uplifting. Apart from the month of Ramadan, the holy month of Ramadan, that fasting, of course, is obligatory in it. Throughout the Islamic calendar, there is no any other time that fasting in it is so recommended and so rewarding more than the month of Rajab, the one that we have just stepped into it. So please let us pray to the Almighty God to bless us, to give us opportunity and tawfiq to be able to fast in as many days in it as possible. Apart from fasting in this month, giving charity always is rewarding to be charitable, but in this month the reward of it will be, as I said, multiplied. Other than that, the dua, there's a short dua in Mafati and the books of dua. You can refer to it and read it after every prayers. This dua, ya man arjuhu li kulli khair wa amanu sakhatahu inda kulli shar, to the rest of it, please get acquainted with it and read it after morning prayers, zohr, asr. Few days you do it, you'll memorize it. It's not that difficult, but it's very profound in its meaning. There is a night that, whether tonight or tomorrow night, that it's or the night before, depending on different calendars, that the basically the first Laylatul Jum'ah, which is from Thursday evening until Friday evening of the month of Rajab, is so rewarding in dedicating ourselves and spending some time in worshipping of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That there is a hadith that that night is referred to as Laylatul Raghaib. Laylatul Raghaib, which means literally the night of hopes. There is a hadith that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends his angels to earth, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was recommending his companions, was telling them that make sure that you are not heedless of Laylatul Raghaib, the very first Laylatul Jum'ah and the day of Friday of the month of Rajab, because angels come to earth and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking the angels, ask me and I will grant you. And they say, ya Allah, we are only praying so that you forgive those who fast and fasted in the month of Ramadan, to forgive them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants their prayers and their wishes. In that particular night, there is also a 12 rakat prayer in the form of 6 2-rakat, 2-rakat prayers. The details of it, please refer to the books of dua, find out, spend some time. We really don't know whether next year we'll be alive or not. Even inshallah, we are, hopefully we will be, but what we can reap for our hereafter in this month is very special. There is an abundant blessing awaiting us. Let us endeavor to God and pray and do our very best to be able to, inshallah, gain as much as the spirituality and rewards that we can for ourselves. Finish it about the most significance of the month of Rajab with this hadith that on the day of judgment there is a special category for Rajabiyun, that there will be a divine cry, Aina Rajabiyun? Where are those Rajabiyun? Rajabiyun is an expression for those who observed the sacredness, the holiness of the month of Rajab and fasted in that month, even at least one day. Of course, the more the better, at least one day. Or gave charity in this month, or special dua, whatever that was possible for them. And above all, they guarded their eyes, their ears, their hearts, all their limbs and bodies against committing a sin and against all types of evils. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Now, in the month of Rajab, when you look at the Islamic calendar, you'll see that it is so rich with variety of occasions. That's again another significance to the month of Rajab. We have numbers of birth celebrations, as inshallah next week we'll be celebrating the birth anniversary of Imam Jawad alayhi salam and the birth anniversary of Amirul Mu'minin Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. We also have some sad occasions, as the one that we are getting here together tonight, commemoration of the martyrdom anniversary of Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. In the middle of this month we have also the wafat and the demise of the heroine of Karbala, Sayyid Zainab Salamullah alayha. Commemorating and observing such Islamic occasions of the birth or the martyrdom anniversaries of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam are according to the words of Ma'asum, in particular the one that we are commemorating his martyrdom tonight, I mean Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam, is in fact a means of proximity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So those who are after practical irfan and after really spiritually uplifting themselves, the more you get connected with Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, the more you observe such occasions, the more you remember Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, the closer inshallah you'll get to the Almighty God. That's what Imam al-Hadi in that heavenly ziyarat al-jami'ah that I'll introduce it to you very shortly, the Imam says, وَمُتُقَرِّبٌ بِكُمْ إِلَيْهِ, that when you are visiting any of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt, say that, my dear Imam, by visiting you, visiting your shrine, by greeting you, I am making myself closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So observing the occasions of the births and the martyrdoms of the Imams have such benefits. Very briefly about Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. Imam al-Hadi, of course, his father was Imam Jawad alayhi salam, and his mother, her name was Sammane Maghribiye. So she was from Morocco and she was Umm Walad. Most of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, by the way, their mothers, they have been Ummahat Aulad. That means they have been female slaves, freed, and the Imams have married them. From them, they had children. You recall, inshallah, that the one of the wives of Imam Jawad alayhi salam was the daughter of the king of his time, Ma'mun, which was actually sort of a marriage of convenience, if you want me to call it, or a marriage that was imposed on the Imam. The Imam had no children from her, and that was the will of God again, similar to the case of Imam Hassan al-Mujtaba alayhi salam. But this lady, although she is a female slave, freed, but look at her personality, her character, that the Imam himself, when he talks about his mother, he says that Shaitan does not get near her. She was called Sayyida, although biologically she was not related to the Prophet or Fatima al-Zahra, yet because of her character, she was known as Sayyida. She was known as Ummul Fadl, the mother of all the virtues. Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam, at the age of 8, he became an imam after his father Imam Jawad alayhi salam. Very young, he was martyred. But that was not an issue anymore for the Shia community, for the reason that they had this issue with Imam Jawad alayhi salam, and the clarification had been made. Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam, his imamah was about 33 years, and at the age of 42, still very young, he was poisoned to death at the time of one of the ruthless kings of Abbasid with the name of al-Mu'taz. In fact, Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam lived during the time and the reign of five ruthless kings of Abbasid. The most ruthless one, that the most famous one, that almost half of the life of the imamate of Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam was spent at his time, was Motawakkel. Look at the hypocritical names and titles and nicknames that they had chosen for themselves, those Abbasid rulers. Motawakkel is the one who had destroyed the shrine and the grave of Imam Hussein alayhi salam and flooded it so that no one is able to go and what do you call it, visit the shrine of the Imam. Motawakkel is the one who in many occasions he attempted to assassinate and kill Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam, but the leave and the will of God was against it, and therefore he did not succeed until he was killed. I can't remember exactly whether from one of his brothers or son, he was in fact killed, and they inherited the kingdom from Motawakkel. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. I had a very busy week today, but I couldn't convince myself to skip it, so inshallah I hope that I can share something with you very briefly tonight, inshallah, to share the rewards of it. Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam had several contributions, as the name reflects and the title nickname that was given to Imam Ali an-Naqi, al-Hadi, meaning the guide, was because the Imam was really a divine God at his time, as the role of all the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam was. To give you some examples, at the time of Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam, there was a perverted ideology coming up, emerging from among the Shia, so-called Shia. Those who were thinking that, well, look, Quran is not comprehensible by us, we cannot understand the Quran, and therefore they were only relying on narrations. A similar attitude that year, some centuries later, was developed and known as Akhbariyin. The very beginning of it was started at the time of Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam, and the Imam clearly stood against that, and in various occasions proved it by quoting from his ancestors and quoting and proving that always the Holy Quran is the main principle and the manifestation of Muslims and Islam. Narrations and anything else must be examined and cross-examined with the ayat of the Holy Quran, without going to the details of it. A second contribution, a very important contribution, was again a discussion, an ongoing discussion about determinism and free will. Please, if you have time, get that book, Tuhaf al-Uqul, that is also translated in English, and look at the part that is about the words of wisdom of Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. Reflect on it. In other occasions I've sort of elaborated on it. The Imam has such a brilliant thesis about the issue of al-jabr wa tafid, or determinism and free will, and has really explained that that issue very thoroughly and brilliantly, of course. Another contribution of Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam was with regards to some theological issues that at that time, again, as still the mainstream Sunnis, by and large, they are suffering from that misconception that they had given some physical sort of attributes to the Almighty God, claiming by the apparent meaning of some of the ambiguous ayat of the Quran as if God has eyes, as if God has legs, and so forth. Although they say that it is not exactly as we have it, but similar. But how it is, we don't know. The Imam says again in one of the hadiths, on the one hand, he denounces and renounces tashbih, that God is not similar to anyone or anything at all, laysa kamithlihi shay. On the other hand, also he's renouncing ta'til, that no one can say that God is not similar to anything or anyone, and therefore we cannot get to know him. No, you can get to know God without giving him similar or likening with anything or anyone. Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam, also we have such a brilliant visitation and ziyarah from him, that Sheikh al-Tusi and Sheikh al-Saduq rahmatullah alayhima, they have narrated it in their books of Man la yahdurul faqih and tahzib. These are among the four most important books that we have, books of hadith. I remember before, again, I had spoken a bit about that Ziyarat al-Jama, and to my counting, there are 227 or 228 characters of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam listed in that Ziyarat al-Jama al-Kabira. I really urge anyone, tonight I can only unfortunately talk to you very briefly on this, on the surface, and just introduce these. On every issue that I mentioned, there are discussions, and some of them, alhamdulillah, we have had some lectures about them. Those who really want to know the status of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salam and want to thoroughly study the issue of Al-Imama, I refer them to the best source and the most authentic, and that is Ziyarat al-Jama'at al-Kabira. In a sense, Ziyarat al-Jama'at al-Kabira is similar to the Dua Joshan al-Kabir. Dua Joshan al-Kabir contains 1,000 divine names of and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if anyone wants to know Tawheed and the divine names and attributes, Dua Joshan al-Kabir is the best source that you can possibly find. Likewise, for those who want to know the Imamat, Ziyarat al-Jama'at al-Kabira would be the best source for it. Again, sallu ala Muhammadin wa ala Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad wa ajil farajah. Now, for tonight, just briefly, because the time that I have is very also limited, one hadith to learn from the words of wisdom of Imam Al-Hadi alayhi salam. And really, if you ever have been into some difficulties, hardship, turmoils in your life, if we can remember this hadith will be a very key to our success and how we are expected to deal with the calamities of life in a successful fashion, in an Islamic way, so that inshallah we can reap the rewards of it. The hadith is this, that the author of Durratul Bahira, Shahid al-Thani, has narrated it, and I'm quoting from that book, from Al-Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. I mentioned the hadith, please bless your mouth and repeat with me word by word until I give a little bit of explanation as my time allows me. Alright? And Al-Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam, the hadith is from Imam al-Hadi Ali al-Naqi. Al-Musibatu, everybody inshallah, Al-Musibatu lis-sabiri wahidah وللجازع اثنتان. I repeat only 4 or 5 words really. المصيبة للصابر واحدة وللجازع اثنتان. Literal translation, it means that calamities, hardship, turmoils, difficulties of life, for a patient person is only one calamity, one hardship, one problem. A patient person only has got one problem, and that is the hardship that he or she is facing. But للجازع, meaning that for the impatient person, the one who does not have the patience, is two. In other words, he or she is facing two difficulties, two calamities. Why? Because the first difficulty is what we are all facing sometimes in our life. A man came to Imam Ali alayhi salam and says that, Ya Amir al-Mu'mineen, would it be possible for me to pray that, Ya Allah, I don't want to be tested. Who should I see? I don't want to be tested. The Imam says that that's a dua that never be granted. Don't ever say that, Ya Allah, don't test me, don't trial me. Instead, what you need to say that inshallah you will work on it and will be granted is to say, Ya Allah, make my test easy. As we read it in the dua here, Ya man yaqbalu al-yaseer wa ya'fu an al-kaseer. Oh, you the one who accepts little but gives much in rewards. God, make my trial easy, my test easy, and help me to pass it also as well. So, as part of the trials of life are the hardship of life. Again, Imam Ali alayhi salam says that if you are expecting to come to this world and never get sick, never lose any deer, never lose any money, never lose any deal, never any discomfort, unless you are one of the mustadrijin, otherwise you won't be living in this world. Alright, so it's part of the deal, it's part of the test of this life, facing difficulties, hardship, calamities. But if you are patient and endure with it patiently, you will win and you will reap the rewards of it. But if you are impatient, and the meaning of impatience is that you keep nagging to God, complaining about God. God, why me? Why out of everybody only me? What have I done to deserve this? And keep complaining about God and about what God has made for you, then you will be facing two difficulties. Number one, the difficulty that you are facing, and number two is losing the rewards of it. Because for every hardship, no matter how tiny, how little it is, there is always a promised reward for it, subject to our patience, subject to not losing our faith and not to complain about God. But if I do complain, then my calamities become two. One, the one that I'm dealing with, like a person who is suffering from ailment, and the second, his or her nagging will cause her to lose the rewards of it. And therefore the Imam says, Al-Musab man hurima thawab. If you want to know who is the real person who has been afflicted by a calamity, he or she is the one who has lost his or her rewards that otherwise would have it. So that's the meaning of what the Imam says, that if you are patient, the hardship is won, and you will get the reward of it and will pass anyway. But if you are impatient with the meaning that we gave, therefore your calamities will be two. Who wants to duplicate it? And that's why our Urafa, they say that Sat Hezaran Kimia Haq Afarid Kimiai Hamcho Sabr Adam Nadid. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created so many elixirs of life that can really improve our spirituality, but none will work as much as the patience would do. In Surah Al-Ra'd, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala quotes something very brilliant. And I don't have time to go to the details of it, but let me touch this one and inshallah we'll move on. About the significance of this gem of patience. That so many virtues will enable us inshallah and will bless us to be able to be admitted into paradise, to live therein and inshallah eternally with all the bliss. Out of all of them, for sure patience must have a special role in it. Why I say that? Because Quran, when he's quoting the communication of people of paradise and those who've been preceding us and now they are receiving us, when we receive, Quran says, this is Salamun alaykum bima sabartum fa ni'ma uqbad dar. Salamun alaykum bima sabartum. Salam on you, peace be on you. You've entered the house of peace, the place of peace, Darus Salam. Why? Bema sabartum. Because of your patience. Couldn't they say because of something else? Or so many reasons, so many other issues that would bless us to go to paradise. That shows that patience is such an important factor to allow us to enter paradise. And that's what the riwayat says, that it's like the head of our faith. You cannot imagine someone to be headless. Likewise, you cannot imagine that I have a faith, but I have no patience at all, with all different types of patience. So the humble contribution, the very simple contribution, but profound in meaning, from Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam for tonight, inshallah, to bless our gathering, is this. Please memorize it. Keep it with let's keep it with us and try to practice in that. The Imam says that al-musibatu lis-sabir wahida wa للجازئة إثنتان. صلوا على محمد وعلى محمد. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. Okay, I mentioned that Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam lived during the time of five of the ruthless Khulafa bin al-Abbas, the Abbasid kings. Motawakkel was only one of the ruthless one. Let me share with you one memory and one incident about the how Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam encountered Motawakkel. Motawakkel, as there were so many spies he had put against the Imams, and there were some people that they were really spreading some rumors against the Imam and misinforming the king against the Imam. One night, as that ruthless and vicious king Motawakkel, he was drunk in his palace with his female singers and you know people he had around himself, he decided to summon Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. And this story, you can imagine that how effective the words of a ma'soom would be, how much Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had given them ta'thir nafs, meaning that when they were talking, how much it would be influential. He summoned Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam, who had already called him to Samarra, which was more of a military base, to be able to watch the Imam more and control his traffic and who visits him and everything. When the Imam was brought to the palace, to the court of al-Mutawakkil, the Imam noticed that it's a very sinful scene. The so-called Amir al-Mu'minin is drunk, and so are people around him. That Motawakkel al-La'in, he turned around and said to the Imam that, Ya ibn Rasulullah, ahlan. Now, come on. Come and have a sip with us. Astaghfirullah. The Imam says that, Wallah, no drop of alcohol, intoxication, wine has ever touched our mouth. We are not that type. He said, all right. In this case, sing a song for us. And I've got my musicians to play the music. The Imam says that, أَنَا قَلِيلُ الرَّوَايَةِ مِنَ الشَّعْرِ. I'm not a poet, I'm not a singer. Even the poems that I know are not much. He said, no, this one you cannot skip. You have to do it. You have to tell us some poems. Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam says, well, if that's the case, then okay, I will. But look at the poetry that the Imam said and how it affected people who were drunk even. أَيْنَ الْمُلُوكُ وَأَبْنَاءُ الْمُلُوكُ وَمَنْ قَدَ الْجُيُوشُ أَلَا يَا بِئْسَ مَا عَمِلُوا. Imam says, oh king, where are the kings before you and the princes before you? Where are those commanders of the armies? What are they now? Batu ala qulal al-jibal tahrisuhum غلب الرجال فلم تنفعهم القلل. The Imam continues and he says, do you remember that they used to have palaces on the top of the hills, so well protected, bodyguards protecting the palace? But where are they now? And you can imagine the king and his companions, all who are drunk, are getting affected. Really, it's touching them. وَاسْتُنْزِلُوا بَعْدَ عِزٍّ مِنْ مَعَاقِلِهِمْ وَأُسْكِنُوا حُفَرًا يَا بِئْسَ مَا نَزَلُوا. The Imam says that, let me now tell you, where are they now? After living in such high rises and high rise skies and palaces, top of the buildings. Now after those so-called glory that they had made for themselves, now they have been acted under the dirt, inside graves, a very small place. ناداهم صارخ من بعد دفنهم أين الأساور والتيجان والحلل. The Imam says, brothers, it's for us also as well. Look at the words of wisdom of the Imam, how touching it is. The Imam says that a crier cries after they are buried, says, hey, these were the kings and the princes. Now you tell me that where are those gold-made bracelets that they had, and the crowns, and all those the silk-made attires and expensive attires that they used to wear. أين الوجوه التي كانت منعمة من دونها تضرب الأستار والكلل. Now you tell me more. I've got a question. Where are those faces, chubby faces, who looked so delight? Because of overeating, obese bodies and so forth, because of so much food and variety of food and drinks available to them. Where are those that there were numbers of gates and curtains before you would possibly be able to see them? Where are they now? Now look at the answer. The Imam says, فَأَفْصَحَ الْقَيَابَ عَنْهُمْ حِينَ سَأَلَهُمْ تِلْكَ الْوُجُوهُ عَلَيْهَا الدُّودُ تَنْتَقِلُهُ. The Imam says that now the grave talks for them. They can no longer talk for us to hear. Therefore, their graves talk for them. And says that, are you asking me about those such people after they are being so humiliated, buried inside me in that pitfall, hole inside under the dirt? I tell you, on those so-called delight faces, worms now are walking, insects are walking around them. قَدْ طَالَمَا أَكَلُوا دَهْرًا وَقَدْ شَرَبُوا وَأَصْبَحُ الْيَوْمَ بَعْدَ الْأَكْلِ قَدْ أُكِلُهُ. For so long they used to eat and drink, it's now about the time that their blood be drunk and their flesh be eaten by some other insects under the dirt and on the ground. As the Imam was reciting this, such an eye-opening and really awakening poem, Motawakkel became conscious. Really, it was like you're hammering on his head. And so were people around him, and he started weeping and crying. And he set the Imam free and let him go back. He said, stop it, I don't want to hear it anymore. Because he could tell what the Imam is telling him. He could get the message from the Imam. But eventually, not by Motawakkel, by at the time of Mu'taz, they could not stand to see the Imam being successful in his career, and therefore they assassinated him by poisoning him to death. Brothers and sisters, Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam, at his time in Samarra, he was gharib and lonely. Would be so difficult for his companions to pay a visit to him and learn hadith from him. Likewise, even still, Imam al-Hadi and Imam al-Askari, whose graves are in Samarra, a city that predominantly is again inhabited by radical Sunnis, they are still gharib. You remember what they had done to their holy shrine some years ago. Please, if I may request tonight, it's a very holy night, very holy month, very holy occasion. Let's take advantage of this opportunity. Please close your eyes and open the eyes of your heart. If it's possible for us also to turn off the lights here tonight, and let's make a quick trip to Samarra in Iraq and visit Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam, along with his son Imam al-Askari alayhim afdalus salawat wa tahiyyat, because bu'd manzil nabuwat dar safar ruhani. There is no hardship to make a spiritual trip with our soul. You can just close your eyes and imagine that you're standing at the doorstep of the holy shrine of Imam al-Askari and Imam al-Hadi alayhim as-salam, and asking, أَأَدْخُلُ يَا اللَّهُ أَأَدْخُلُ يَا مَلَائِكَةَ اللَّهُ الْحَافِينَ حَوْلَ هَذَيْنَ الْحَرَمَيْنَ الشَّرِيفَيْنَ. Seeking permission, now let's step in and quickly pay a visit to Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. السلام عليك يا أبا الحسن يا علي ابن محمد الزكي الراشد النور الثاقب ورحمة الله وبركاته. I wonder if anyone in this gathering does not have any knee. This is the opportunity now. We visited Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam. I cannot fathom that he will not visit us back. I cannot fathom that you brothers and sisters from such a remote area, you paid respect to Imam al-Hadi alayhi salam, pleasing the holy heart of his grandson Imam al-Hujjah Jalallah Farajah Sharif, and now be conscious of your needs and those who've asked you to pray for them as well. Let's together finish it with and conclude with this part of Dua Tawassul. As I read it, please remember those who've asked you to pray for them, remember your needs, and remember the quick reappearance of Imam al-Hujjah Jalallah Farajah Sharif. Get what you want in such a blessed gathering tonight. يا أبا الحسين يا علي ابن محمد أيها الهادي النقي يا ابن رسول الله يا حجة الله على خلقه يا سيدنا ومولانا إنا توجهنا واستشفعنا وتوسلنا بك إلى الله وقدمناك بين يدي حاجاتنا. Under breath, follow me, let's do it all together. يا وجيها عند الله اشفع لنا عند الله. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد بأعلى أصواتكم. اللهم صل على